Attorney De Lima, sorry, before you continue, I just have to ask, how much of the decision was because of what you went through? As I said a while ago, it nearly broke you. How much of your decision was because of what you went through? How much of it is because of your political ambition? How much of it is because of country and her people? Attorney De Lima.
Much of a combination of what I went through and also for country and for people. I never backed down from any challenge. And because of what I went through, I have to consistently show that I remain resilient, that I persevere, that I remain a steadfast advocate for the right values. I'm part of the LP, and at the same time, I'm also part of the ML, which is the sectoral wing. And ML is a people's party list. ML is a genuine party list. It's not tied to any political dynasty or to any business interests. Now, political ambition, because, well, I've never been a politician before. Before I became a senator when I ran for senator, first run in 2016, because I'm not into politics, really. I was just, I was convinced by the former president Pinoy and Secretary Marrojas that I also joined politics. So under the first run, I won. Unfortunately, in 2022, when I ran for re-election, I did not make it. I was in detention, so there was lots of challenges, and so it's a combination of both my journey of what I went through as a victim of political persecution and injustice, and also because of my desire to contribute more for our country.
Of course, that decision
was a very difficult decision.
Right, and that decision was not made by you alone. I'm sure there was a lot of planning here as well, a lot of strategizing as well. You have a lone Liberal Party bet in the person of Kiko Pangilinan there at the Senate. Why go the party list route?
Yes.
Why didn't you join him?
Well, as you mentioned, you can say that it is also a strategic move. Now, you know that the senatorial fight is a tough one. It's a tight one. With so many, the usual people there, the money, the very popular people there. And if you base it from the surveys, it looks like most of them would still be making it. And we have a lone Liberal Party candidate at this point because we feel he has the greatest chance of making it from our ranks. Now, that's partly strategic, but most of all, I saw really the party list route through ML Mamamayang Liberal as a most ideal platform for me to pursue further my advocacies. And we, the LP would want to reach more to the communities, to the marginalized sector, to listen more. Because you can say we learned from our lessons in the past that, the image that we were projected to have, the elitist kind of an image. Now, we want to disprove to the people that it's not, and it is through sectoral wing, which by jurisprudence is allowed, that a major national party can have its sectoral wing that can participate in the party list elections, representing this time marginalized sectors give it a higher chance of success in the party list elections. So, because the whole idea of the party list elections, as affirmed, recognized, and highlighted by the Supreme Court, is inclusivity, to open a wide array of participation through the party list representatives.
Attorney De Lima, glad that you mentioned the marginalized sector. There is a thought here that the Liberal Party, sort of really what happened to you guys is that you marginalized yourselves by not keeping your ear on the ground, by not being, by not knowing what the people really needed at the time. You said it yourself, there was an elitist, you know, image of the Liberal Party. What lessons are you bringing into, as you said, the ML has been there for quite a while, but let's not kid ourselves here. This is a new face of the Liberal Party now that you're entering into. What lessons are you bringing from the past? This listening tour that you speak of, that's been going on for more than 5 years, close to 10 years already. So what have you heard and what are you bringing into ML as you gun for a congressional seat come 2025, Attorney De Lima?
Okay, the core values of the Liberal Party has always been democracy, social justice, human rights, and a free market economy, and also solidarity with nations, liberalism. Now, many of our people do not exactly appreciate those values, especially those on the ground, especially those on the communities. Okay. And we have projected ourselves as really just representing those highfalutin ideas and ideals or values. Now, the lessons learned here is that we were not able to really articulate them more, reach out the communities to explain further what exactly these values represent that can further empower them, that can help out in their daily struggles. So through the ML, that is now the platform. We are reaching out. We want to listen more to the masses because these are multi-sectoral sectors that may be bound by distinct aptitudes or distinct aspirations, but actually they are bonded together by the common pursuit of social justice. That is the whole, that is the overarching cause of ML, which is so much aligned to the Liberal Party's causes. That is social, really social justice is the clarion call for our party list, ML.
When did you, just a brief answer to this, because I have a few more questions for you before we let you go, Attorney De Lima, when did you figure it out? When did you think amongst yourselves that, okay, this is not working, there's got to be another way, and ML is the way to go, at least to strategize for a presence at the House of Representatives if you figure out that former Senator Kiko Pangilinan is going to be your lone bet at the Senate for now? Go ahead.
The realization of having ML as an ideal platform also. That's been there actually for a few years already. In fact, ML tried to accredit with the COMELEC. It first filed its petition for accreditation in 2020 for purposes of the 2022 elections, but the COMELEC denied it. So we filed another petition this time for the 2025 elections. We filed it in December of last year, and it was granted by the COMELEC this July. But the realization, the talks, the discourses, the discussions about the need to further reach out to the marginal sectors has been there already for a few years. Now, the strategizing about just having a sole Liberal Party. Of course, we wanted more. And in fact, they also were urging me to join the senatorial race. But as I said, after much reflection, I actually decided to go by the party list route through the ML because I believe in the causes that it represents. Mm. And I'm part of one of the marginalized sectors, the women's sector.
Yeah, I'm sure you're well aware of, you know, why there was a need for the party list system to begin with. And for a while, it really did serve the marginalized sector, only to find itself in its iteration now as it serves as the back door for moneyed families, for extensions of dynasties? How do you then distinguish yourselves? ML, how is it distinct and separate from how it is being used now as a backdoor for these dynasties, these families, just to get, you know, just to get into that seat of power? Go ahead.
We are a genuine party list. As I mentioned earlier, we are not at all tied, or we are not at all supported. We are not at all backed up by any political dynasty or political dynasties or by a business interest. And that is exactly what ails the partyless system now. You know, that because some, it's just some, it's, there are other genuine, there are indeed genuine partyless and organizations. There are indeed those who represent truly marginalized sectors, but there are, has been put up there by political dynasties, you know, just to strengthen their hold in the House of Representatives, and that what gives party lists a bad mark. And the entry of ML now would be one way of putting in the House of Representatives and magnifying sectoral representation by a genuine partyless organization, because we have multi-sectoral. We are a multi-sectoral partyless group. We represent women, youth, farmers, laborers, fisher folk, IPs, LGBT, and urban poor. And that's why one of the nominees, the second nominee, is IP sector. And then Congressman Erin Tanyada has always been an advocate for farmers' rights, fishermen's rights, urban poor's rights, because a nominee must be a member of the marginalized sector or any one of the marginal sectors that it prefers to represent, or is an advocate of any of those sectors. That is clear by jurisprudence.
All right, Attorney De Lima.
We want to put in the whole system another genuine party list.
All right, Attorney De Lima, as you very well know, alliances matter a lot, especially at the House of Representatives. When you talk about alliances, how far will you go? Considering that days after your release, you called President Bongbong Marcos Jr. a blessing, are you going to go there? Are you going to form an alliance with a supermajority now in power at the House of Representatives, should you win after the 2025 elections? Go ahead.
I can only say about, you know, at present, our position has not changed, that we are not entering into a coalition with the administration ticket, and we remain to be an opposition. We may be coalescing with other kindred groups also in the opposition. And ganun din sa ML. Well, ML, we will be also coordinate with the other partyless groups, kindred partyless groups. Although, as you know, in the partyless elections, only one partyless is voted upon, by the voters. But then, insofar as coalition is concerned, it's too early to say that if we win, are we going to coalesce with the administration right now? And and even in the future, because we'd rather be the opposition. We remain to be an opposition as a fiscalizer of government.
All right, final question for you. Before we let you go, Attorney De Lima, I'm sure you're well aware of what is happening to Vice President Sara Duterte. You were once there. You felt the whole of the bureaucracy sort of go against you. How is it viewing things from the other side now, Attorney De Lima?
Okay. We are, of course, monitoring very closely this QuadCom hearings, and then the hearings, the budget hearings involving the budget of OVP and DepEd. And while we can see really that there is some political angle there. And I think that is something that that cannot be avoided. It is inevitable that there be some political dimension. But look at the issues. These are legitimate issues. We are talking here about accountability. But here is somebody, the second highest official of the land, who is disrespecting the proceedings before the House in those committee hearings, even declining to take an oath, which is unprecedented. No resource person, I think, in the history of Congress has ever denied or refused to take an oath. What does it say of a leader like a VP Duterte? So we are, of course, watching very closely these developments. And we certainly hope that the outcome of all these hearings would be really not just of course, because these are inquiries in aid of legislation to come up with the right policies to fix the system and also to hold people accountable. Not being able to explain confidential funds, not being able to justify her department's and her office's budget, the OVP and the DepEd, is a major red flag. Because we're talking here about accountability, we're talking about people's money.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Attorney Laila De Lima there, former Philippine senator, who had just announced as well that she is going to go for a congressional seat come 2025 under the Mamamayang Liberal Party list. Thank you so much for taking our call. Appreciate talking to you. And thanks for taking out some time to talk to us as well this noon.
Thank you also, Carmina.
Thanks
a lot. Have a good day.
You too. Former Senator Laila De Lima there joining us this noon.